So I'll be speaking on the evolution of a project till now, and till what stage have subsystems reached till now, and what is the work ahead that lies for us. So how did this idea come about? The aim was to develop a student satellite, a small satellite, in a time frame of 2 to 3 years. More importantly, it has to be a very low cost and low mass. The low cost is ensured by using COTS, that is commercial off-the-shelf components, and the success of the mission that we have is highly dependent on the learning that we would be getting from the project, and not totally dependent on the final launch, final output. To your right, you can see some student satellites that have been launched before. Only one has been launched from India till now, and that is Anusat. The idea was to make IIT a respected center for advancement in satellite and space technology. We wanted to launch at least 5 satellites in the next 10 years, and satellites can be used as test beds for new technologies that come up and tried out in space for qualification. We come to the mission statement of Pratham. So what exactly will define the success of Pratham? So we've got 4 mission statements to our thing. The first and most important thing being acquiring knowledge. We have set a lot of emphasis on acquiring satellite and space technology knowledge, and a lot of weightage in quantitative terms to the mission success is also given to the learning part. Designing the satellite by the student body and launching it from ISRO are the other two mission statements. The payload that will go on the satellite is to measure the total electron count in the ionosphere. We also have a social goal to involve other students from other universities, and we have taken 2 or 3 endeavors towards this, which I'll be coming to soon. As you can see, a lot of weightage is given to learning. Then as soon as we have a flight model ready, we claim that we have achieved 50% success. The rest are the different stages that will be achieved once the satellite is launched. So some basic facts about the satellite. The satellite is a cube of 26 centimeters. It has solar panels on 4 sides. A launch vehicle interface will be attached from VSSC. The orbit that we are looking at currently is a 1030 polar sun synchronous orbit. And the satellite has 2 pre-deployed monopoles for as part of the payload. We have no uplink, and the mission life is estimated to be 4 months. The team distribution is as follows. We have the core group members at the top. This includes the project director and the subsystem leaders. And we have got the different subsystems that work along with them. Apart from the different subsystems, we have a separate integration team, quality team, and a PR team. Integration team essentially handles the assembling of or bringing together of all the subsystems, and the quality team is a very important team. Basically, a lot you need to assure that whatever you're delivering will stay there. Another important part of we have students from all departments working on this project. It's not just aerospace or electrical. Different departments have come together to actually make this project a success. These are technical mentors of the project. Professor Sudhakar, Professor Muzindar, and Professor Arya have helped us a lot and are helping us consistently with that. Professor Sudhakar is also the project director. So this is how we have gone about till now approaching the problem and how we are going to approach it later on. The first phase was concept feasibility. So Saptarshi and Sashank had approached Professor Sudhakar with this idea of building a satellite, that the students of our department want to build a satellite. And the idea was approved by the professors. After that, a test was conducted and a team was imbibed. Then next came the requirements capture phase. In this, essentially, we looked at defining the various subsystems. What subsystems does a satellite need to have? What would be the different requirements on each of the subsystems? And how do these requirements come about? And initially, we were looking at 2 different payloads, thermopile as one of them, and the total electron count as the other one. But eventually, we concluded with the help of ISRO that thermopile is actually a very tough thing to do as a first project. So we just focused on total electron count as a payload. One very important thing that we learned in the process from ISRO was that system engineering needs to be there as a subsystem. We had missed out during our initial requirements capture. It is very important because that is the subsystem that brings about all the subsystems together. It does all the necessary work like routing, looks after the routing of wires, managing important documents like weight budget, data budget, and all those things. So all these things are very important, and it plays the most crucial role. You may have all subsystems working individually, but making them work together is the role of a system engineer. Next, we came on to the conceptual design phase, where we thought of initial concepts of the various subsystems that would be there on the satellite and how these concepts would go about meeting the requirements that were laid on them. Additional requirements also came in the process. We learned more in the process that, okay, these requirements also need to be there. At the end of the conceptual design phase, review was carried out with ISRO professors, and they were very happy with the work done till that stage. After that, we moved on to finalizing the concepts that will be used in the preliminary design phase, and so the concepts were frozen that will be used. And the MOU has very recently been signed, just 2 days back at ISRO, and we have moved into a detailed design phase where we are just going on optimizing the design so as to get it properly functioning with the current concepts. Hopefully we should be able to launch, we should have a satellite ready by April 09. Now I'll go on to the individual subsystems of the satellite. What were the requirements on the subsystem, the current state of the subsystem, and the work left. So payload does not have any requirement, it just puts in requirements on other subsystems. The payload, as I mentioned earlier, is to measure the total electron count of the ionosphere. That is a part of the mission statement, but we would also like to do ionosphere tomography. Ionosphere tomography means I need the ionosphere TEC map over the whole of India by having a ground station at certain locations only. Also, as a part of the social goal, as I mentioned earlier, we have conducted national ground station workshops in which 11 universities have participated. You all can also participate in this. VJTI current also was one of the participants. The second part of the social goal is the MHRD virtual experiments which we are doing with CD. I'll show a small demo of those experiments later. Next comes the communication and ground station. So it takes in requirements for payload that it needs to measure the total electron count. So that's why we need two monopoles on the satellite, which are transmitting at two different frequencies. So we measure the polarization by Faraday rotation. Due to the difference of the Faraday rotation of the radio waves transmitted from these frequencies, we are using two crossed Yagi at the ground station to receive data and measure the polarization. The approximate cost of a ground station that we have estimated right now for other universities is very low. It's approximately 25,000 only. And we are encouraging the 11 universities that had come to us, and more universities that will come to us, to set up ground stations so that we can get the TEC data at those stations as well, which will help us in a tomography. The attitude determination and control subsystem, the goal of the subsystem is to stabilize the satellite once it is launched and to maintain all the three attitude stability. This is required for communications and payload perspective, since we would like to transmit it. So the sensors that we are using are the GPS, single axis sun sensor, magnetometer, and magnetometer. The control law, as of now, we have finished designing the control law. We have finished designing the Kalman filter required for it. The work left is doing a stability analysis of the control law, a robustness analysis, and manufacturing accuracies are needed. These three things are the work that needed to be done. We are a bit stuck at the stability analysis right now. The onboard computer subsystem is required to store the communication data that will be sent to the Earth, and also to do the control law calculations that are required from the sensors. The hardware that has been finalized is on screen. The ideology behind developing the software was to keep it simple, and for our task we concluded that a cyclic scheduler is enough to carry out all the work that we need to do. Hence we just stuck to a cyclic scheduler. A very important part of OBC is to test it with the other onboard components, and that is it's called HILS, hardware in loop simulation, where I'll come to that later after the power subsystem. So power is like one of the most important subsystem required. It runs the satellite essentially. We decided to put in solar panels on four faces. Two of the faces we decided not to put them because, as you can see, the power contribution from those two faces is not very significant. They are the nadir and the anti-sun set respectively, as compared to the other four faces that you can see. This was done because we needed some area available for thermal coating so that you can maintain the temperatures of the satellite. Else you just had one face where you can put in your thermal coatings to maintain the temperatures. As I was talking about HILS, it essentially is an online inboard in-loop simulation where you have your OBC and your power circuit. You simulate the space by using computer inputs, but all these inputs are taken in real time. So it's like the OBC and the power circuits are being simulated in space by the help of real-time computers, essentially. This testing is required to prevent the infant mortality, generally, due to the probability of electrical components generally failing is really high initially. ISRO has given us a number that the circuits, if they are left on for 320 hours, then the infant mortality can be neglected. Then the possibility of infant mortality happening is very low. So, hence this kind of testing is necessary. Coming to the structural subsystem now, structures, it has to qualify the launch loads and also the thermal loads in orbit. The simulation software that we're looking at is ANSYS, and we've also carried out experiments in our own labs to validate those simulations. So the simulations that have already been done are modal analysis, harmonic analysis, static simulations. Random vibrations have been done, but not yet been validated via experiments. All the other simulations have been validated via experiments done in a lab. The thermal subsystem. The idea of the subsystem is to maintain the temperatures of the satellite within allowable limits. The most critical component over here is the battery, wherein the allowable components are just 0 to 40 degrees Celsius. The fluxes that the temperature cycle that satellite generally experiences can go from minus 100 to plus 200, depending on what kind of coatings you use. So, a lot of different things need to be modeled in these equations. We had a lot of problems using a lot of commercial codes. We tried Fluent, we had tried Nastran. Eventually, we went on to our own C++ codes. This code is also available online. It's being run on the Pratham website. Mechanisms. Initially, we had thought of deploying the two monopoles as soon as it was launched into space. But because of lack of quality assurance, we could not finally implement that. So the mechanism was implemented, but we decided that we would not go with this mechanism, and since we did not have the mechanical quality assurance over here. So eventually we decided to go for pre-deployed monopoles. The other mechanism is the snap mechanism, which is to tell the satellite that you are launched into space, essentially. Right now we are waiting for details to come from VSSE. For the current mechanism idea that has to be validated. Here is a picture of the mechanism, monopole deployment mechanism that we already had made. System engineering and integration. So all these subsystems, even if they work function properly, does not ensure the success of the satellite. System engineering and integration is what brings all of these subsystems together. The work of a system engineer, I'll go step by step. The work of a system engineer is essentially to put in the requirements on the subsystem and the system requirements as well. Maintain the weight, power and the data budgets. Then comes the integration part wherein the interfacing of connectors and wires and the routing of wires, making of the configuration layout, connectivity diagram, operational sequence, integration sequence. Level one, so there are three levels of testing. Level one testing is where you just test the individual subsystems. So like in communication, we already finished the testing of the circuits, impedance matching has been done. In power, the circuit has been totally tested. In thermals, most of the codes are validated, just a small part of it left. Structural validation testing is done via the experiments. Level 2 testing is essentially testing wherein more than one subsystem come together. For example, hills, wherein the power, the OBC subsystem come in together. And level 3 testing is essentially the total testing of the model. By vibration testing, that's the testing of the flight model essentially. The vibration test and the thermo vacuum test. Quality assurance is very important. It refers to planned and systematic production processes that provide confidence in the product suitability for its intended purposes. So there are three kinds of quality assurances: electrical quality assurance, mechanical, which is generally assumed to be one, and software quality assurance. Software quality assurance essentially implies running through the codes. Clean room, we are in the process of building a clean room, and we are almost done, of a 1 lakh class. Inside IIT in our department only. These are some pictures of that's the power circuit over there. This is the communication circuit, the Yagi antenna, that's the rotor, and that's the mechanisms over there. We have laid very major emphasis on documentation and reviews. So we want this to be a continuous thing. After us, we want more student satellites to come up, and we don't want that the efforts that we put in for literature survey and finding out all the details about smart satellites and getting this knowledge go waste. So we have laid major emphasis on documentation. All our documentations are available on our website as well. We have regular reviews that are conducted by professors and also from ISRO scientists. We already had finished two of our reviews. These are the organizations, ISRO, ISAC and VSSC, IIT Bombay, RCCD, AEA, Samir, TIFR, Boeing. We had given a presentation to Professor Madhavan Nair, who had come down to IIT Bombay recently. Let's take a small demo of the...
Using off-the-shelf components, right? So, Atmel seemed to be a natural choice. Though we later shifted to AVR family microcontrollers because we were more comfortable with them. But essentially, the choice was made because they are off-the-shelf components and we had particular requirements for our subsystem. And hence, we chose the particular microcontrollers. Currently, we are using AVR Atmega 128.
The microcontroller and embedded board will withstand in that temperature?
The temperatures are maintained well within ranges on the satellite by thermal subsystem.
So essentially, it is the goal of the thermal subsystem to maintain the temperatures of the body between 0 degrees and 40 degrees. All COTS component can withstand temperatures between minus 40 and 85. Currently, already thermovac testing of the power circuit, hot chamber testing of the power circuit and the communication circuit is done, and it could withstand well above 40 temperatures. So the thermal subsystem will ensure that the temperatures lie between 0 and 40. We have seen that it works in that range.
Once you put the satellite in the orbit, if you want to tilt or move, you are following any mechanism? In case by mistake it will turn some degrees?
That thing will be ensured by the control law that is there. So even if there is some disturbance in the orientation of the satellite, so basically what the control law essentially does is maintains the attitude of the satellite within plus minus 10 degrees of all three Euler angles.
No, you are controlling from here or?
It's totally autonomous. There is no uplink at all. So, the all the sensors and the magnet augers will maintain that attitude of the satellite.
Thank you.
I have a question. How many of you think that your college students will be interested in participating? Okay, terrific. Terrific. I think you give your contact address. If it is not already displayed at lunchtime, you're going to join us for lunch. They will be here. They organize a lot of workshops. This is quite different from all other satellite projects because it is done completely by students, as you would have seen. There was no faculty member at all. The faculty members are there just namke vaste, give some guidance and so on, but they are doing the entire work. So it's an unusual thing. I would invite as many colleges as possible to participate, all your students. Okay. They do organize workshops. In fact, they have ready-made material. You can, your people can get started in no time.
The documentation available on our website will act as starters.
Okay, the person who is leading this is Saptarshi. I'll ask him to say a few words.
Hello, this was Manas, who was a team leader for thermals, and Saptarshi Bandapadai. We kind of myself and Shashank started it off 3 years back as this project. So as sir just brought it up, so I really wanted to speak on this. What's the social goal in this? I'll tell you why we started off. We felt we were at the right time at the right place to get an opportunity to do this project. You know, in IIT we had this opportunity, but we feel it's our duty to spread it all over the country. And for that we held one workshop. So for that what we do is, first of all our data, everything that we are collecting is up there on our website. So Manas gave you the website link with C-Deep Thermals on it. If you go to Pratham website, essentially, you'll get all the other data everywhere. So we'd like you to have a look at it. Then secondly, we are setting up this virtual labs. That was the C-Deep Thermals part. Second part of it is the ground station workshop, where if you see the world map of TEC map of the world, you'll realize it's just one data point for India. And hence the GPS errors or any errors which use TEC data is very incorrect in ourselves. In a sense that when you take a GPS reading, you'll get a plus minus 10 meters of error if you use a GPS over here. Hence it's not very good for driving and all. You won't know whether you're in this lane or in the next road nearby kind of thing. Whereas if you see US and all, infinite lot of data points. So why couldn't we have a lot of data points in India? That was our question we asked. That would really change the way we work and over here. We could actually land aircrafts without any pilots, things like that, which is being done in US, which we can't do today. So what we encourage a lot of universities is make ground stations above in your university. Then what happens is it becomes a TEC point. It becomes just a data point like this. Then we can have a map of India, TEC map of India. Then we can actually use that data for a lot of purposes. Now, there are a lot of people who are interested in this data. VSSC is interested in data. And a lot of international organizations also want. This data is completely open source. We are not going to charge for this data. So how do you make a ground station then? So what we did was we downsized all the cost and we brought it down to 25,000. That is how much money you need to make our ground station for Pratham. So you can actually talk to Pratham using that. Talk, matlab, we don't have uplink ourselves. So you can just receive the data and you could measure TEC and that data and you kind of establish a satellite ground station on your own university. So that was the idea with which we are holding all these workshops. So we'd really like if you all are interested to form student teams again within your society, within your university, and contact us. There's a lot of contact information and all available on our website. So once you do that, we would be glad to help you all. And so we have already done two workshops, and there'll be a few more. There's one in October, sometime in the end of October. So we would gladly like a lot of you all to participate in it. Thank you.
What we could do is, as a part of your CS101 real program, in December, we can actually do some of these things. You know, every day, one half an hour. Because you would have seen that we are doing lots of things. And there are many things in which you yourself can contribute. For example, Amrita is doing a lot of things on their own LMS. I see Sona College doing some work on hardware. So it'll be a good idea. Some of them you will get ideas, some of them from us, some of them you can contribute, you can bring your students. One of the problems, one of the things that we are also trying to do by all this is to excite our students. You know, this is one thing that, you know, in fact, Saptarishi should add this. What is the educational component of this, you tell? Can you explain that? I think that is the most important thing.
Sir, I mean, all of y'all are professors and I'm just a fifth year student. The point is, we started it 3 years back. We actually knew nothing about any of this. What are satellites and all? We didn't have an idea. So we all learned it in the process, and that has enriched every sphere of our work. It has enriched the way we look at our own courses, the way we interact. It has, one of the most important things I have learned is the power of failure. Is that when you keep failing, you keep failing, then you succeed. And we have gone through a lot of stages now. So that is, those are, and trust me, there's so many such countries. Manas was stressing on system engineering. Right now we are working on quality. These are terms which were kind of never exposed in our normal curriculum. But these are things that we deal with in our day-to-day life over here. So it's really changed the way, not only me, but my entire team has kind of looked at technology and looked at the way systems evolve with time. So the learning, the education, that's why in our mission statement also 50% weightage is given just to the learning that is involved. So we say that when the satellite is ready and to be ready to be launched, we have achieved 50% of our mission. That's a very big statement that we are making about the learning associated with this project. Thank you, sir.
So with that, I think we should conclude this session. We should